And this is the last verse in the first Aliyah. Can you believe it? We've got short Aliyot these days. So who would like to read this one?
No problem, I'll read it.
Go for it. For the time.
Okay, so Adonai Eloheka, hu over lefenecha, hu yashmi et hagoyim ha'ele mil benecha bi rishtam.
Good.
Yeshua, hu over lefenecha, ha'asher diber Adonai.
Nice. And I let it slide on the Yeshua because it is the same root, almost the same name, but Yehoshua, right? Oh. Yeah, but nice. Okay, great. And of course, Yehoshua is a type of Yeshua, right? You know, we see a lot of his life as being kind of a shadow of what the Messiah was going to be like. Okay, so let's see this first part. So, Adonai Elohecha. So how do we translate that? Adonai Elohecha? Yes. That's right. Adonai, your Elohim, or your God. Okay. Shem. God. Hu over levanecha.
He will go over?
Yeah.
For you?
Yeah, that's good. And notice that Yonatan said will. That's very good. You caught that. Hold on, come back. Will. Oi, too far. Come back. Oh, sorry. Will. Pass over. Over. Okay. Lefanecha.
Before you.
Before you.
Is Ober a active participle?
It is. Very good.
And so, do we have two emphatic pronouns there, the who?
Interesting. So the first one's not really emphatic. It's just governing the Ober, right? So here's our noun. Here's our adjective, right? So the verbal adjective, the active participle, is in a way modifying who, right? So that's just like our subject, right? Actually, you're right. I'm wrong. You're right. That is emphatic because we already have Adonai your God. Yeah, so it is emphatic. You're right. Good catch. Emphatic pronoun. You're right. So we should translate this Adonai your God. He himself will cross over, will pass over. And note that Yonatan knew it was future, right? Because it's not happening now. Moshe is prophesying. He's saying what's going to happen. Hey, don't worry. Yehoshua is going to be with you, and Adonai is going to cross over with you. He himself, not a malach, is what's being implied. Not a messenger, not an angel. Before you. Hu yashmid. Good, and that's, you're right. This one is also emphatic. I was thinking only the second one. They're both emphatic. He himself, yashmid. And actually, the way that you know this is emphatic is yashmid. What's yashmid mean, guys?
Destroy.
Yeah, destroy. So this is from the verb shamad. Shamad. And shamad means like ruin, to ruin, something like that. And this is a hefil form, right? You see it's hefil? From the yod there? Hefil. So literally to cause to be ruined, right? Or to destroy. So, what form is this? Perfect or imperfect?
Imperfect.
So this one, it also sets the tone for the time, right? For Odell, right? That it's going to be future. So he himself, we don't need the who here. Yashmid means he will destroy, right? So this says he will destroy, right? So who yashmid, he himself will destroy et ha-goyim What's goy mean?
Nations.
Yeah, that's right. So the nations. Ha'ele.
These nations.
These nations. And notice. Go ahead.
Question. How come the verb obeyer is active participle, and you have an imperfect yashmid? How come it did not use the imperfect also of abar?
Yeah, that's a good question. The question is, since we have a verb that's in the imperfect, like yashmid, why don't we do the same thing with avar? And this is the best answer I can give you, is this is just something stylistically that happens. You could have done that. You could have put it in the imperfect. That's no problem, right? But it's stylistically Moshe is using the active participle here. Yeah. I know that's kind of a non-answer. Can I just say style?
Okay.
Maybe style, right? Like, yeah. Like sometimes.
Would there be any interpretative significance?
Well, you could say, well, okay. For in the realm of I don't know, gematria certainly is affected, right? So if any of you believe that sometimes there's some truth to the idea of the numerology of the Bible, like the numbers that the letters represent and being a connection to have some deeper meaning, some sod, secret meaning. I'm not speaking against that or for that. Certainly that changes. If we change this to be imperfect, we have a yod introduced now, right? So the gematria value of plus 10 to it will be different, right? So that's just one take. Let's see.
You know, Rabbi, I was going to tell Raymond that one of the professors at the school, when he didn't really know, he said it's just in a poetic form.
I'm going to use that. Thanks. It's just being poetic. It's cute. Yeah. So I think style is probably really kind of our best bet, you know. And the active participle, you know, it's so flexible, right? It can express so much. If you like, you could maybe put a future progressive to this, right? So Adonai, your God, will be crossing over before you. He himself will destroy, right? So you can maybe, because again, we're having an active participle, it maps to so many things in English. Sometimes it's like a gerund, right? And so in English, gerund is basically, we get a noun concept idea from an ing form of a verb, right? So for example, to run becomes running, right? And so you get the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, The Running Man, right? You know, he's the running man. What kind of man is he? He's a running man, right? So you have, it's modifying the man, right? It's adjectival form, like verbal adjective in Hebrew. And so because of the ing form, some translators, they do like to, when they see an active participle joined with an imperfect form, they like to say, will be doing whatever it is, right? So he will be crossing, right? And similarly, if they see it joined to a perfect in the sentence, they'll translate as past progressive, right? So if we, instead of Yashmid, if we had Hishmid instead, if it said Adonai Elohecha hu over lefalecha hu Hishmid, then some would like to translate that as Adonai your God was crossing over before you. Notice crossing over before you. And then you might have to say, when he destroyed Et HaGoyim HaEle, these nations, right? So I don't really think that's true all the time, but there might be some justification to people doing it that way. So I hope that's a bit of a better answer for you, Doc. Try it on. See if it works for you. To when you see the participle combined with imperfect, make it an ing form of the verb and see if that works nicely. You got it?
Yep.
Okay, sure. Especially since we're kind of four in different times in Hebrew, so. All right? Good. All right, let's. Any other comments, questions? All right, so continuing on. Notice Ha'eli, it's agreeing, right? So the nations is our adjective. Okay. Our adjective. And he's definite. And it's masculine, and it's plural, right? And so Ele Well, this is plural demonstrative, right? So it's plural, and this one goes for masculine or feminine. There's no difference. And then he's definite, right? So it agrees. Okay? Mi lefanecha yivishtam. What's mi lefanecha mean?
From before you.
Good. From. So we know that mean, it can assimilate like that, contract like that. Cat just jumped right out. Hello, buddy. Mi lefanecha. From before cha, you. And by the way, if you're curious, if you're interested, this style here of putting mem in front of lefanecha, like we really don't need the lefanecha, do we? We don't need the mem, right? Before you is enough. From before you? In case you're interested, this is a Phoenician style, right? So another Semitic language. Sure, we're not saying that Moses is borrowing from Phoenician, but we do know that Adonai uses the prophets based on their experience. So he gives them sometimes the direct words, and other times he inspires them to write using their own style. And Moses, for a certain, would have been fluent in Akkadian as a dignitary of Egypt. The high-level nobility in Egypt, at that time, they had no Akkadian. It's another Semitic language. That was like the international language of the day. And, Phoenician, not too far off. So it could be that Moses was just influenced by Phoenician, perhaps, from some of the documents he read, and so his Hebrew has it. Or it could just be that at this stage of the Hebrew language, it just so happens that Phoenician have that in common with Hebrew. So Phoenician loves to stack up like particles in front of, particles in front of inseparable prepositions like that. So mil, mik, etc. So mil falecha, from before you, virish tam. Okay, what's yarash?
Dispossess?
You're right, it means both. It means possess, or it means to dispossess. And not like a demon, not that kind of like possess, but we're talking about property. So this word, context, is totally king. So yarash can mean to possess. Help me with the spelling, people. P-O-S, one S or two?
Two.
Two, okay. And is it two at the end also?
Yes.
Okay. Just looks weird to me. To possess. Okay. To possess. And then it can also mean to dispossess. Right? So it depends on context. If you're the peoples in the lands, then you're being dispossessed by this word. We don't have to put it in mefal or anything like that. The word itself means both, it has both an active and an intransitive meaning. So, okay. And then what's happening with the vav there? Can somebody tell me why do we have this weird spelling of the vav with and? Okay, the hirik underneath. What's going on? Why is that a hirik there? I would expect a schwa.
Is that rule, that schwa rule, where you said the yod turns into a, is it like a compensatory lengthening that takes place?
Because very good.
Yod used to...
Very good. So when we have a word that starts with a yod and a schwa, you're right. Instead of stepping through all the rules, we'll just, maybe we'll look at it. You have your yod and the schwa, and then the vav, we try to put a chirik under it. Okay? But what happens is the yod says, hey, I like to be an e sound too, like predator and prey. So then he loses his vowel sound, and he kiesses, some say elides, he becomes part of the chirik, the long chirik now. Right? So that's what happened over here. But actually, let me correct our yod color. Part of the vowel. Vivishtam. Okay. You shall dispossess. M. What's the M mean?
Them.
Very good.
Them.
Okay. Yehoshua. Who's that? My brother's name. Yehoshua.
Joshua.
Yeah, Joshua. Did I ever tell you guys it's supposed to be my name? I was supposed to be named Joshua. Yeah, but who was this relative? Was it my great aunt? I think it was. Oh no, it wasn't B. She never married. All right. Well, I had this. I can't remember who it was. One of my relatives. She was married to a Yehoshua, and he had passed on. and my parents are going to name me after him, right? And then this old bat, she had this dream where he's in her dream. Sounds like a movie or something. Don't give away my name. It's kind of a weird, creepy nightmare. And so that's it. I didn't get the name Joshua. So instead, they named me after my grandfather. So it's kind of funny. So, and then my brother, she's already long gone. My brother got the name anyway. So, all right. So, Yehoshua, who over lefanecha? Yehoshua, who? Who?
He.
Yep. He. Over.
Go over.
He will pass over.
Yeah. He will cross over. Or pass over. Either one. Cross over. Good. Lefanecha.
Before you.
And notice here, Moshe doesn't say Milefanecha. He just does the more standard Hebrew. Lefanecha.
Like.
Good. Before you. Okay. Ka'asher dibe Adonai.
As Adonai has spoken?
Yeah. And actually, by the way, this is going to be emphatic, so you probably. Oh, wait. Come on. What do I do? Probably going to be emphatic again, right? So he himself. Maybe he himself. Because we already have Yehoshua here, right? We don't have to put who. Okay. Kasher, yep, as Adonai spoken, very good. Kasher diber Adonai. Kasher diber Adonai. Okay. And let's look at this pointing on Kasher. Can anybody tell me why there's a patach here? Oops. Okay. What's up with that? So, what are the rules for attaching an inseparable preposition? If I want to put kaf in front of a word, what's the first rule? What I try to put for a vowel sign, vowel marker, underneath the kaf?
Schwa.
Right. Try to put a schwa. And so if I try to attach it to word asher, we have a violation if we do that, right? Because what's the violation?
Oh, I see what happens.
Right?
Okay.
So you can't have two schwas. Right? Oh, sorry, I should let you say it. Yeah, exactly. I knew you saw it, so I decided to say it. Right? We can't have these two together. So what we have to do is we have to do compensatory lengthening. But in the case of a composite schwa, usually we would lengthen this to a chirik. But when you have a composite schwa, instead, what he does is he just copies whatever that vowel sound is that's next to that's part of the composite schwa. So this sign here is going to be copied over here. That's why we end up with Ka Asher. Okay? Don't get confused and think it's like V or something like that. Just for pronunciation, it's easier. For some reason, instead of Ki Asher, they'd say Ka Asher. Okay? According to which, literally is what it says, Dibeh Adonai, Adonai spoke. And here you'll notice instead of Dibeh, the usual spelling for PLs, we discussed with Yomar recently, the usually spelling for the third person masculine singular is Kirik, Dagesh, and Seri. But look here, we've got a Segol. Who can guess, or who understands why that Segol is there? What's happening? It's kind of advanced, so. It's not really construct, because you can't put a perfect into construct, but you're on it. You're very close to what's happening. When we do construct, something happens that makes a vowel shorten, right? So, is something similar perhaps happening here, right? So, what's happening is that they just read these two words closely together, right? Kind of like as if they were in construct state, right? And we have a little hint at it. This mericha, this accent mark, is hinting that he's closely connected to the next word. And so, that, with the combination of the very strong sof pasuk, I can't color it, this little marking the end of the verse, tells us we're reading those words very closely together. So in ancient times, they would have said like, give out on I, right? It would have been something like that, as if it's a compound word, right? So, good. Nice. Just for a moment. Well, this is the end of the first Aliyah, and give me just a moment. Yes, children. What? 15 minutes, that's it. Yeah. All right. Okay, so let's see how we're doing on time. Okay, we're an hour in. So, great. Any questions on these? Any comments? Are you guys benefiting? Sha!
Yeah.
Yofi. Okay, oh, let me just check something here. If I have a... So there's a comment in the Masora, right, which are the notes on the Masoretic tradition. It says on this part where we had, where we have Adonai Elohecha, who? The Lord God Himself, or the Lord your God Himself. This is one of the three places in the Bible, or the Hebrew Bible, where the text both begins and ends with the Tetragrammaton. So we have, so the Masora, this is the Masoretic scribes, right? The scholars who gave us the vowel points and stuff. They're pointing out and noticing an interesting thing in the tradition here, in the text. And so basically they're just saying, hey, by the way, there's only three places in the entire Bible where you get, let me do a highlighter here. Let's try purple. You get Adonai. Okay, it's yellow. That's not purple, but whatever, maybe it's better. At the beginning and at the end of the verse. Oh yeah, it's my mouse. Fine. So if that's interesting to you, it only occurs three times. So maybe there's some significance to those verses in the Tanakh. Right? So we said the first word and the last word are both the Tetragrammaton, a very special marker. The other places it says are first Shemuel, chapter 26, verse 23, and Yeshayahu, that's Isaiah 38, verse 20. So who knows, that might be worth an investigation, see what's going on there. Shall we do the second Aliyah? What do you guys want to do? Do you want to do the second Aliyah, or are you done?
I know I'm good.
Good? All right, let's do it.
Hey, you did it. This is the end of this part. Watch the next one. To support our projects, you can donate at www.patreon.com/HebrewLiteracy. You can do a single donation or sign up for monthly donations.